Mick Rhodes, you know, I think there's more than 140 here. I am Mick. I am interested in people, pain and philosophy. Roger promised chips.
You did.
I wasn't coming unless you gave me chips.
You've had chips because you put so
posh
far.
Posh ones.
I've only had posh ones.
Mick Thacker.
Stop. You should never, ever clap people till you've heard them talk. They can come out with complete bollocks. Right? So, Mike, I'm so happy to be in the Midlands. I can swear. I can mispronounce words as I want to because, you know, I can talk in my native tongue. So I'm a Lincoln lad originally, sort of down the road. You know, God, if she exists, God chosen county. So that's where I'm from. I hope to entertain you a bit. Hope to get some serious things across to you. I hope to bring quite a lot of the things that people have talked about together. And Roger gave me a title, Complexity, Science, Pain, and Humans. And thank you for doing that, Roger, because those are things I'm interested in and think I've got something to say. Don't worry, there's no S&M for those people who are very much aside. I'd show you a few pictures. There's a bit of audience participation, particularly amongst the learned few here. Where's my mate Nick Spar? There he is at the back. You've got a role to play, Dr. Spar. So let's get going. I'm going to take you through really a talk that, in the end, we want to get to this thing called predictive processing. One of the things I'm lucky enough to be doing is a second PhD with a guy called Professor Andy Clark at University of Edinburgh. He's the David Hume Professor of Metaphysics and Logic. And the reason I'm doing that is I did a molecular neurobiology PhD looking at chemokines inside of nerves and why that gives you pain. And I realised that wasn't going to tell me an awful lot about pain, but it was an interesting thing to do. And then I did some neuroimaging with Nick and other people to try and ask different questions of a different level of the nervous system. And all that did was generate more questions. And it seems to me that philosophers are the type of people who know how to ask serious questions about serious things and ask them in a way that challenges us to overcome, you know, accepted biases in a field, accepted dogma. And that's something that I've sort of hopefully spent much of my career trying to do, is to challenge dogma. So I'm going to take you through some of the traditional views of pain, some of the things that we were involved in that sort of tried to change some of those traditional views, and then some of the work that I'm currently involved in. And I've got to say that if you take notes or you tweet or whatever, this is work in progress, particularly the last bit. That's not apologetic. But I've already had people use some of my slides and say, this is how we should understand pain. I'm spending the next 5 years of my life trying to disprove that that's how we should deal with pain. Yeah, that's what my second PhD is about, trying to say, well, predictive processing might have some answers, but we'd love to show that it's not the right thing and we need a better model. But I think it fits in with a lot of what people have talked about. So this is Pat Wall, if you don't know. I was lucky enough to start my PhD with Pat, and I hope most of you do know who it is. And Pat was a really interesting guy, polymathic. I haven't got a chance to talk, but just to give you a bit of insight, Pat lived in an anarchist commune at MIT with Noam Chomsky, was in the same lab as Warren McCullough, Walter Pitts, Jerome Letvin, and some of the guys who started the world of AI off. And he's a pretty intelligent, funny, very kind human being, lectured while he was an undergrad at Oxford in philosophy. Was actually a really, really decent chap to be around. And he made sort of several comments, and these are two of my favourite quotes. Pat talked about things like eminence grise, which were suggestive that people are just trying to prove the existing sort of dogma and will construct experiments to create data that just basically proves what we already know. And he was particularly keen to point out that where pain's concerned is it's almost impossible to replace accepted simple schema with things which are more complex. And I do read on Twitter and other things, people trying to simplify pain and telling us all the time we can make it simple. It's not because I wish it to be complex. It's a complex subject. When people simplify it, I don't think they do the topic justice. I think what they do is take us on these sort of simplistic models that actually create real problems in the clinic, and I'm going to point some of those out, like you are your brain, and all pain is in your brain, and that means all we need to do is retrain people's brains and then their pain will go away. In my opinion, it's bullshit. You know, where I'm not a very good philosopher, is I don't have that ability not to say things like I think it's bullshit. But that's only my opinion. You don't have to listen to me, and I would encourage that you don't. All right? But these are sort of diagrams. If you pick up a book that you see, things that are labelled like pain sensations. So, right, I'm ignoring you. Stephen's here. All right, this is the first bit of prac. If I hit Stephen, right, he's a Sheffield United fan, so there's every reason to do so. If I'm not putting pain into Stephen's system, I put a high threshold stimulus to Stephen that may be transduced and having an effect on his nervous system. That if his nervous system thinks the best way to actually explain that away is to give him a pain response, a percept of pain, then he will be in pain. I haven't put in pain. There's no pain travelling from the periphery, up pain fibres, up pain pathways, up to pain centres in the brain. And the number of eminent people in the field who still use that nomenclature. I'm going to appeal to my philosophy friends. You know, you had this huge attachment, and I am sort of a card-carrying philosopher myself, with a bloody C fibre. You know, if C fibres are active, people are in pain. David Lewis, who I know you guys think was a very bright man, but probably spoke a lot of nonsense too, you know, was attached to the C fibre. Yeah? If the C fibre fires, people are in pain. 70% of all the C fibres in your body are postganglionic sympathetic fibres. They have nothing to do with pain. Never, ever. And people label them as pain fibres. Got to stop even. So I would encourage you, pick up a book if it says that. Put it down, it's rubbish. Go to a lecture, someone says that. Walk out, go and have beer. Don't waste your time. It's all a fault of René Descartes, you know, and Cartesian dualism. Although Descartes was a man of his time and he should be seen as one of the brightest human beings who's ever lived. Where his description of pain comes in is really quite limited, and it's a brilliant causal model. Is there a laser pointer on this?
Yeah, the back button.
In the back. Yeah, so look, you know, stimulus. Put a stimulus in. Travels through a pain pathway, doesn't, up to the sort of brain, and then you get an outcome of a perception of pain. It's fundamentally flawed, but you were all taught that sort of nonsense at college. If you're a physiotherapist, I apologise on behalf of all physiotherapy lecturers you've ever had if you believe this sort of rubbish about pain. I'm apologising on behalf of our profession, great reflexes, for the nonsense you have been taught about pain. Yeah, and I've been quite serious about that. You deserve better when you're an undergrad. We should do this, but how we wish he went into recycling. It's going to pop up and it will come out in my talk. All right, and what we add is all these descriptions of pain pathways. And again, they blame people like Hewlings-Jackson, but they miss what Hewlings-Jackson was talking about in terms of hierarchies, in terms of pathways. What he was really motivated by is not simple reflexes, how it's often been interpreted, was these incredibly integrated loops. He was one of the first people who was interested in epileptic fits. Don't want to do that, do I? That's all right. I just trod. You can see there's a weight differential. Everybody else has been walking here, nothing else. Yeah. You know, Roger was only wrong about the wrong game, you know, forward, not footy, you know, rugby's the game. But Hewlings-Jackson was the first person studying epilepsy to suggest that the brain is able to hallucinate, to imagine any potential sensation that can be transmitted through an afferent system. And we'll come back to that later, so hold that thought. And there they are, my two heroes, Pat Wall, Ron Malzack at MIT. Malzack basically was interviewed by Pat by taking him to the pub, drinking Johnny Walker, Black Label whiskey, till he got him absolutely pissed, and then made him turn up to the lab at 5:30 the next morning to do an experiment. And that's how Malzack got to work with Pat Wall. It's an absolutely true story. So, all right, but he went home at 5:35 to go back to bed. But they developed this thing called the pain gain theory, and we haven't got enough time today to go into it. But if you still believe it's all to do with the large fibres charge into the spinal cord and reach the cord quicker and close the gate before the C fibres arrive, it was never described like that. But I bet you were told that sort of nonsense when you were an undergrad, right? It's to do with synaptic weighting. It's to do with the quanta of neurotransmitter and the synaptic efficiency for that transmitter and the relationship between C fibres and large AB fibres, A delta fibres. And it's actually due to opponents. It's the interrelation of those two things, not just once. It uses the other signal as a comparator. It's highly complex. But it's been reduced down to some ridiculous model by people who try to oversimplify it. But it is limited because it's still basically an input-output system. Yeah? But what it did do is it introduced the idea that the brain is actively engaged with modulating both facilitatory and inhibitory to those signals at the spinal cord. So in other words, the brain can override or it can amplify the signals from the spinal cord, so you have descending control. But there's still this notion from it that everything begins with an impulse in the periphery. And what I hope you're going to learn by the end of the afternoon, in fact, things start from a prediction from the top downwards, and the input, the sensory signal, is used just as a corrective element to correct for whether the prediction from the brain is accurate or not. We'll get to it. But it did produce these things. And, you know, we've hinted at some of them. TENS, acupuncture, mobilisation, CBT, spinal cord stimulators. And you can take your pick which ones of those you like and which ones you don't like. And we could have a show of hands. But in RCTs, and they've been really lambasted today, and rightly so, right? RCTs have not shown any of these things to be effective for pain. Probably spinal cord stimulators, which physios don't want to tend to for complex regional pain syndrome, probably the only one with good evidence. But we shouldn't be asking those sort of questions. We better asking these sort of questions. Better to ask for whom do they work and when. And that brings us back to this N of one idea, you know, and hopefully we'll get to that more. But what was the pain gate replaced with? Well, Melzack developed this idea based on the idea that you thought that pain was tri-dimensional, had a sensory discriminative, a cognitive evaluative and an effective motivational component. And this was an idea to put those things together to explain pain. And in all people, these three components would be at play. So it drew in anatomy and physiology. But it also suggested that the brain was able to generate its own sensory experiences. So again, reaffirming the ideas of people like Hulings Jackson. And the output he described as a neural signature. It was always a theoretical, anatomical and physiological model. And some of us sort of played around with it. You can begin with my good mate, Louis Gifford, who Matt talked about. And always when I talk, I always have to sort of get a bit emotional about talking about my good mate, Louis. Died, as some of you know, of prostate cancer a couple of years ago. And Louis proposed this model. Louis is an evolutionary biologist before he became a physio. So, in fact, he was a zoologist, and he had this idea, in fact, that we should see people as mature organisms who have used their past experiences, their beliefs, the culture they've grown up in, to shape the way that they will respond to activity in their tissue and their environment. This is quite a progressive model, which was challenging to physios at the time, widely accepted, but challenging to a lot of people, and we did some modifications of it together. Still an aspect of this which is a bit behavioralist, still a bit input driven. The idea is that it's circular, that we get in, starting to get some tighter marrying between how people exist within their lived world and how their environment will also influence them, not just their tissues. And that was taken a bit further forward by another good mate of mine, Lozzie, Lorimer Moseley. Although I don't like this model, as some of you know, I've written about it recently, where Lorimer and I, great mates, disagree, go to the pub and have a beer, which is the maturity I still think our profession needs, the ability to disagree with each other and not get over personal about it, you know? It's not, no need for personal attacks. We can agree or disagree. I think this is very brain-centric. You know, Lozzie's idea of how dangerous is this really is just a brain formulation, right? But again, it's ignoring the fact that actually the person, it's a person who has a brain. You own your brain. Your brain doesn't own you. All this bullshit, Pat Churchill, and she's got things to blame for this. You know, you are your brain. So your brain can independently just make decisions. It's an incredible thing, piece of anatomy. We said it can give out or perceive or generate these hallucinations, but it does so in the context of you and how you interact with your world. Yeah? It doesn't do it just randomly for itself. All right? So those of you worried about the singularity, you know, either an artificial intelligence singularity where machines will control the world and they can make their own decisions, or a brain singularity, because that's one that's very real, these brains can control you, then they are part of you. They can't exist without connection to the rest of you. Although, you know, I do some work with David Papa now at King's, and we spend afternoons pontificating about the brain in the back. Although I've got him to move away from C fibres, but I haven't got him to move away from his materialistic nature that brains in a vat would still be highly intelligent things. All right, so this gave idea of a construction of a neurotag. And this is one of the big downsides, I think. People believe that all you need to do is look at a brain scan, pick out the different components of the brain that are sort of alike on a brain scan, and then you can determine what the person's got. So the amygdala, if the amygdala's like, that person must be in fear. If the insula's light, that means they must be somehow worried and concerned about that experience. And we're going to show you why that's a load of old tosh in a second. All right? But if you want to make a pain matrix in a neuroimager, you can do it perfectly. Here's a fantastic example by our group of the pain matrix. Beautifully alight there. So all the key areas there. S1, S2, thalamus, insula, cingulate gyrus, hypothalamus, but all on there. And this is what most people in the neuroimaging world would like you to believe is going on in you. It's a pain matrix. And these things are developed only when you look at healthy people and do a very controlled stimulus in a laboratory situation. And much of our work, and I keep referring to Nick, because Nick did a PhD with us and demonstrated in patients that these things don't hold up particularly well. But also, they don't hold up in the clinic if you do good science. So this is Giando Iannetti's work and Andre Morrow's work showing that if you give a noxious stimulus, a non-noxious stimulus, yeah, an auditory stimulus or a visual stimulus, pretty much those things look identical to each other. You develop the idea that actually what you're looking at is not a specific pain matrix, but rather what you're looking at is a saliency network. This is just, if you don't know what saliency is, it's the ability to attract your own attention, to generate your own, how, what's this about, if you like, in common language. Yeah? So how much you attend to a stimulus. And just recently, you know, Jando again, but working with Tim Solomons, who's a lovely Canadian guy who basically the British government want to export back to Canada because, you know, they don't think he's doing any good for society. He's just had to prove, as a senior lecturer at Reading, he's doing something valuable for the country because there was a cock-up on his visa. So I've wrote a letter to get him sent back. Tim's a lovely guy, but they just recently took a bunch of people who are congenitally insensitive to pain, have not had an experience of pain, put them in a scanner and demonstrated the pain matrix is alight in these people. Yeah. There's no such thing as a pain matrix. And that's again where I would differ from someone like Lozzie, Lorimer, that Lorimer still will put out to the world of physio there is a pain matrix, albeit with some constraints on that. Yeah, like it's individual, it's not a generic thing. This is not me having a go at Lorimer, like I said, you know, it's things that we're able to talk about. But Craig came along and sort of suggested, oh no, it's quite different to that. It's much more about an homeostatic emotion. And he tried to replace Neuromatrix, which he highly simplified, with something equally as simple on the other side, saying it's really about the interaction of your insula. Insula is your pain centre, and he's published papers in Nature to that effect. But, and your cingulate cortex. And he tried to propose this idea that it was about a need state. But if any of you read Science of Suffering by Pat Wall, that was published about 9 years before that, we'll see that Pat described it as a need state. So nudge, nudge, wink, wink, we'll say no more. All right? But if we look at the insular cortex, we take some work that's done that, and we look at different stimulus again, noxious, non-noxious, visual, auditory stimulus, exactly the same thing. It's unable to distinguish between any of those areas. So is the insula the pain centre, which is still propagated, perhaps mostly at the moment by Irene Tracy at Oxford, thought to be one of the world's leading experts of pain? Irene is a neuroanatomist and a neuroimager. I'm leaving their comments at that. And what most people missed was this, was an editorial in the textbook of pain. And in typical sort of erudite fashion from Pat, it was entitled The Introduction to the Edition After the Next One. And then he proposed this model. He proposed a virtual reality model, a reality, virtual reality model for pain. Still the problem here, for those of us who've got problems with certain types of causality, is it's still stimulus-driven, still output-driven. But here you've got a comparator, and it used things like cybernetics to help shape it. But I want to come back to this, all right? What he was actually saying is that we didn't still, back in the mid-90s, in any of the period after, he never agreed with the Neuromatrix pack. Yeah, even though it was done by his best friend, Malzac. So he said that we've still got a way to go. I can't resist giving a talk without David Chalmers. And he doesn't have that haircut anymore, which I'm gutted about. All right, although we have a son, Theo, who has that haircut. And in fact, he's growing a little Rene Descartes beard. So we have our own Descartes and David Chalmers in our house. Well, I did promise to put a picture in, but I couldn't upload it. And Chalmers developed this idea of the hard problem. Some people don't think there is such a thing, so not all philosophers agree. But Chalmers said we can work out this functional consciousness. We can work out inputs and outputs. But how does all this electrochemical, all this biology, actually transcend or emerge into a conscious state of pain or redness? Yeah? Qualia, he was talking about. He's not a massive fan of qualia, so maybe he wasn't talking about it. But other people would call that qualia. So Chalmers had this idea that, you know, we need to overcome the hard problem if we truly want to explain consciousness. All right? But Stephen's given a hint, and I'm excited to hear him say, maybe emergency is one way we may actually start to solve consciousness. The work I'm doing with Andy, I had a couple of tutorials with him, and he said at the last one, you know, I reckon pain may give us the first opportunity we've had to solve the hard problem. I'm not as bold to say that. Right, but a few years ago, Lozzie and myself, we wrote a paper for a medical journal of Australia saying that actually the existing models we had in neuroscience and neurophysiology weren't adequate. And it was probably about time we brought philosophers to the table. So this is not me just because I'm invited here, you know, licking a few arses to say, yeah, I think philosophy is important. You know, it's actually a genuine belief of mine. And this was the paper I was talking about. What Lozzie wouldn't do, though, is wouldn't put in that we were, by suggesting this was an emergent property, pain was an emergent property, that we were being property dualists. He didn't want the word dualist to be associated with his name. It's not something I'm particularly comfortable with, but that's what we were being. The difference between us still was he thought it emerges from the brain, and I think it emerges from the person. And again, I've written about that, and some of you know that I've got an awful lot of flack, particularly from North America and Canada about that. Anyway, we're playing with some models and saying, how can we link all of this biology we know about and that I've been involved in, like inflammation, neurogenic inflammation, peripheral sensitization, dorsal horn sensitization inhibition, etc., etc. And, you know, my PhD was on how the immune system governs and is involved in pain. We were thought to be nutters for suggesting that 20 years ago. But actually now it's probably the sexiest topic in neuroscience. And it interests some of you to know that one of my neuroimmunology friends said to me, "You're a traitor, Mick, for going off and doing philosophy. You know, no good will come of that, Adam. Wasn't you? All right? No good can come of you being a philosopher. All right? Because neuroscience is the only way we'll get answers. All right? To these questions. We've done the neuroscience to death. It hasn't given us, I think, a 21st century perspective of pain. And the real problem with that is patients are suffering. But rather than patients, let's call them people. People are suffering and struggling because of people's outdated views. And I'm a passionate advocate for people, particularly people in pain. And the other thing is, you'll just notice there's a sort of switch on that, that in the first one, using sort of Merleau-Ponty's idea, phenomenology idea of the lived world, you live inside your own world. Yeah, and it is you who has pain and thoughts and beliefs. But also, you don't want to be constrained by your world. As sort of a left-wing socialist, straight anarchist myself, you know, I don't just want to be constrained by the system in which I live. Right, Stephen, nor do you, do you? Of course we don't. We want the choice to exist in our world, to determine our world within certain boundaries. We want the ability to choose what we do when we want to do it, as long as it doesn't persecute other members of the proletariat. Okay? But quite seriously, when you do assessment of pain patients, I've been involved in some interpretive phenomenological analysis of people who have pain states such as chronic migraine, chronic back pain, and we talk to them and we get their phenomenology, their own perspective of their own condition. One thing that emerges from that repeatedly is the loss of agency. My pain tells me what I can do. My headaches develop what I can do. Irritable bowel syndrome. I have to be 20 yards away from a toilet at any point. Otherwise, I will not go out. I have lost agency to my bowel. No, it's not a way to live your life. It doesn't allow you to be a person. Being a person is about interacting with your world and discovering your world and constantly updating your knowledge of the world. All right, predictive processing. This is what it's all about. How are we doing for time? Probably should shut up, hey? But look, I'm only halfway through. Tough, but this is interesting. You all know this already, and I'm going to show you that. The first example is this. You all know this. I certainly know it. Now read it again. Have you all read it? Yeah? You read, "I got big dick." But it says, "I got a big dick." Then it says, you read that wrong. That awkward, how many of you read moment? It's not there till the next line. That's because you are predictive processing. Look at it. The cat's on the first word. Mat. All right. Jacken. In a good world, it would be Jack and Jack went up the hill. But Jack and Jill. What about the bottom one? Can you all read that? Yeah. And that's a great thing about how your brain really works. You only really need the first and the last letter of a word to be in the right order. The rest can be bullshit. All right, I've written essays like it. All right. Okay, you should do it. You're getting the murder, the all the time. How many of you have produced a poster, G? And then you're like, "Oh shit, I've got two those in," you know? Don't change them. Don't spend another 70 quid the night before, because they'll read it as the. Can't help it. Right, Roger Carey, stand up. Stand up, Roger. Go on, let's whoop when he stands up. It's some intelligence. Woo! Yeah, Roger, he's the man. Roger, next line, please. Let's have Christ our president. Let's have him for our king. Jill. Cast your vote for the carpenter, Woody Guthrie. If you don't know who he is, do yourself a favour. Socialist folk singer from America. Almost like not possible. Stephen Mumford, stand up. Well, I've discovered, I don't know Stephen very well, but I do know you like the Pet Shop Boys. Please,
yeah,
please. Passion, love and sex and money, violence, religion, injustice and death.
Paninero.
Oh, yes. Kevin, you're fucking disgrace. Nick Spar, stand up. You don't get this, mate. I have lost £1,000. Take a sniff of this, then play a little riff. Don't be afraid to try. Don't need no airplane to get off the ground. There's more than one way to fly. Have a little taste, baby. Don't hesitate. Every it don't have to be a song. Great. Name of the song, at least. Rani, stand up. Stand up if you're Norwegian.
Come on.
You must know. You know what's coming next. And my bit is, yes, we love this country as it rises forth. You can now sing it. All right. It's the Norwegian national anthem. All right. He tries to have an... national anthem without the Queen mentioning it. I dream of that day. Money without the Queen. The Irish, I was so jealous. You got to, you know, celebrate having a Republic Day the other day. So jealous. All of you. Corn sweet equation, illusion even. Why do you do that? Because you expect you are programmed to think light comes from above. And that is why you get that illusion, the top one. I hope you've all seen it. What about the bottom one? This is a famous cube made with a concave face, a convex face. And what you're looking at on the left as you look at it is the concavity on the left-hand side. But also that's a concavity straight ahead of you. But why are you, you are conditioned, you are predictively processing faces all the time as things that come out at you. They are meant to be out in the world, not in the world. You can't not see it. Anyone not see it? Because if so, we need to take you to the Queen's Medical Centre. Because it is indicative of a particular type of neurological disorder. Having said that, there are schizophrenics who don't see these as well. All right, so predictive processing, what is it? Well, it's a probabilistic causal inference. It's Bayesian. And I haven't got enough time to go into deep Bayes, all right? But we will point it out to you. So Bayes, I will show you what you really need to satisfy Bayes. It's an attempt to make sense of uncertainty in the world and the cause of current stimulus. So predictive processing often is taught by people as some sort of clairvoyance into the future. No, it's not. It's making sense of the situation that you're in that period of time, receiving the sensory stimulus at that time. But it does have a slight predictive component to it. It's about multi-level hierarchies. Now, Matt, Stephen, people have introduced this idea that actually you have a hierarchy. Is it top down or bottom up? It's a false separation. It's a false dichotomy. It's got to go in the 21st century. All right? Generative models. This is the idea that your brain is able to generate sensory stimulus. But if you say, oh, but you said it can't generate pain. Pain is not a sensory stimulus. The brain can generate, hallucinate, if you like, imagine nociception, but not pain. All right? That's something that's complex, and we'll build that in. All right? It's informed by experience and action, and it's dependent on precision weighting, and that's the key to this. I think it actually ties in beautifully with causal dispositionalism. All right? And plastic adaption. All right? Yeah. So it's about plasticity. So those of you who have learnt a lot of pain, all this gaggle of people here have done MSc modules or MSCs with me, apart from Ian and Dermot, but both of you have had the displeasure of spending time in my company over many years and been tried by them. You know? That's that same pleasure. All right? And, yeah, all the stuff we taught you about synaptic plasticity, that's really what underpins precision weighting. You need to relearn your neuroanatomy, just to be needs to be contextualised. There we go, this is Dave, Dave Chalmers again, but that's Andy Clark, and I would urge you all to go and buy Andy's book, Surfing Uncertainty. Or if you don't want to buy that one, even though I'm getting commission for that one, go and buy Jacob Howie's book. So Jacob is the philosopher, Manashin in Australia. And together they've sort of been doing a lot of work on this idea. So predictive coding as a model is saying, look, what you actually have is you have predictions coming down and you have sensory stimuli going up, all right? But sensory stimuli going up are actually really just errors, yeah? So there's errors measured against the prediction. So if the prediction isn't a perfect fit for the actual sensory stimulus, the sensory stimulus will be projected to the higher centres, correct the model to make a better prediction, and then hopefully be able to explain away the incoming information. We're going to come back to it. Right, this is it blown up a little bit. And what we've got is actually a bit of nuance in here, is the peripheral stuff is very variant. It changes, it's dynamic, it changes readily to accommodate. And that's what peripheral sensory fibres are able to do. They change quickly to match your local environment. They have spatially small receptor fields, so they're quite precise. But your higher centres are much more abstract, yeah? And they respond more slowly. They have much larger receptor fields. Have you ever thought about persistent pain patients often have whole body pain? And often we see in those people changes, real changes in their neuroanatomy when we look on scans or their representation. And that probably underpins this old body representation, because the thalamic nuclei, certain cells within the cingulate, certain cells within the insula, certain cells within the S1, all have old body receptor fields. They have the ability to sense anything from anywhere in your body. Yeah? Whereas most receptors and other types of sensory fibres actually have very small receptor fields. Higher centres are relatively invariant. That's why, as individuals, if you have peripheral base change, there's huge variation. But once you take people with a persistent problem, persistent pain, we can make much more generalisations, still dangerous, but more generalisations, because actually this invariant, the degrees to which you change quickly in the periphery are not matched in the higher centres. But that change takes longer to establish itself, and it's probably a little bit more predictable. Yeah, and those people who are into this say that actually those higher centres are producing counterfactually very rich environments. They are producing things that aren't necessarily happening but could happen to give a choice of models, which allows the right model to be selected and makes it easier, if it's not the correct model, then to replace it with a correct model. Yeah, and I'd love to have a chat about that. Then you guys, because I've read your work on counterfactual sort of elements. All right, this is a slightly different view, but this is Carl Friston's view. And Carl Friston, who's a theoretical neuroscientist at UCL, and a very lovely human being, and sort of said, actually, you know, every living creature is bounded by the need to limit free energy. All right? Because once you start to liberate free energy, you will no longer be able to adapt your environment. You will die. So you're always trying to constrain free energy. Free energy in this sort of schema is about these prediction errors, generating repeated prediction errors. Never being able to make sense of your existing world is potentially dangerous to you. Yeah? And he's been able to model this. All right? And we won't bother with that today. But it's also intractable anyway. You can't solve these equations. They're constraint equations. Alright, suppose we've got limits, upper boundaries on error. What he did say is that if we want to minimise free energy, minimise prediction, we have choices. We can either change the model, we can change the predictions, yeah? By changing the model, we can have neuroplasticity, we can change precision weighting so that we put the preference for a different model in place. Or we can take action, we can change our behaviour, we can move, change our relationship to the world to see if the model fits better then. But we are human beings and we want the freedom to explore, to experiment and to develop, and actually we need to do that to be able to produce relevant models within our nervous system. That's what playing is. Yeah. It's this need to develop models. And it also ties in nicely with the idea that pain is not just about a sensory experience. It's much more complicated. It's about action. And we wrote about that first of all. And again, this is where physios should big themselves up. We were writing about it before most people got into it. Because obviously we're a movement-based profession. You know, topical issues in pain one. And then people like Pat wrote about it in Science of Suffering. Then Lozzie and Dave got up. And then just recently, Colin Klein, who's a philosopher from the... he's now in Australia, but he's American. describe pain as an imperative sensation. It's about generating an action to relieve yourself of it. Right? Fascinating book, although he does all sorts of dualistic things like separate the unpleasantness of the painful experience from what he thinks is pain, which is just the sensory signal, so it gets a bit, for me, a bit out there. Alright? Okay? But this is another way of describing it, so Anil Seth's work. So saying again, you know, you're predicting, you're having these predictions that are fed downwards and then they are matched against sensory inputs, and if they don't match, then you actually pass error on to the higher centres. And that's what you're constantly doing. But you can add precision to either one or the other inputs. And it's late in the day, but these are probability density functions, which show that actually, in a Bayesian terminology, so this is sort of make Bayes, sense of Bayes simplistically for you. A prior is these predictions, sensory signal is obviously what's coming in, and then a posterior is the resultant experience that you get from those things in relation to each other. What's quite clever about this is the prior, it's measured against the sensory signal. Prediction against the sensory signal gives you a posterior, an experience, but the posterior becomes the prior. So it's a bootstrapping. You know, whenever you put your computer on, you boot it. You don't any longer have booting disks. But the idea of that is the first program you have loads the second program, then loads the third program, then loads the fourth program. So you're constantly able to update your models by a sensory experience. You don't need to keep re-exposing yourself. Yeah? So again, it's a bit convoluted. Can you see why if you go and say, it's all about your priors, Mickey said, it's all about your priors. We still got to put some real sort of constraints on this. We've got to define it better. But we do know that we can influence the outcome by changing this thing called precision weighting. Here the precision's weighting put on the sensory input. So the sensory input will determine, much more importantly, the model that's selected. Yeah? But we'll show you another case in hysteria where in hysteria you may put more emphasis on the prior, on the prediction, and that will draw the experience, the sensory experience. And this is great because in the past it's been very difficult to explain why in the same person you can get anesthesia, numbness, and a pain experience. Anesthesia dolorosa, for those of us who know what it's properly called. So in the same person, in the same area of the body. But can you see that all it needs is different neuroarchitecture to be, precision weighted, to be able to drag the sensory experience towards it. And the thing about you is, although you're only ever able to attend to one sensory experience at a time, you can flip very quickly between them, things like binocular rivalry. So you can have numbness, pain, numbness, pain, numbness, pain, numbness, pain. But you can't have nummy pain. How many pay? And anyone who tells you they can dual task, and without being sexist, because as a left wing socialist, I'm not. Generally, it is females who tell you they can dual task. You can't. No such thing. You're a logical impossibility. Stop putting pressure on yourself to be superhuman, girls. There's no need for it. Alright? And this is a different way of looking at things that we've known. Those of you who know anything about muscle spindle physiology, you know, we used to be taught again at college, they stretch receptors, and now no one should think like that. They are stiffness, and they're set partially by the thixotropic behaviour of the bag which surrounds your muscle spindle, but also then reinforced by predictive signals to the contractile component either side of the spindle. And all the time that you are loading the muscle in a way that's predicted, you don't produce a sudden contraction against it. Otherwise you never produce any movement, would you? Because every time you loaded a muscle spindle, you just get a contraction. So if as long as the load on the muscle, including a stretch, matches the prediction, you don't get this, And you can model these, and we won't go into it. But just to say that you can do dynamic causal modelling. And the people who do this, including Tristan, will say, don't think that you can model everything. And this goes with what you were saying, Stephen. You can't. These things are so complex. We were talking last night. We tried to do a Bayesian experiment with some of our students. Not you, like you'll be glad to know you didn't have to do this. And we got up to, because you can put different hypotheses in there, we got up to about 2,751 before we gave up. It's intractable, you can't solve it. Yeah, but what you can do is you can produce relatively simple dynamic causal modelling models, and you can produce injuries and then give them treatments. This is really exciting for the future, because we can, the question came up earlier, you know, what about people who have naloxone but are congenitally insensitive to pain and then they have a pain experience? And the idea would be that we can model that. We can give someone what we think would produce, congenital insensitivity to pain, and we know a lot about that, so we can basically model that. And then we can give it naloxone. And say, how do you give a neural net naloxone? But you just change the weighting in the network to mimic the effects of... And then we could see whether it gives somebody as an experiment. We can do it together. All right, so one of the things I'm going to be producing is these neural nets. But we don't need to, because it was done. And again, if you don't read widely enough, you miss this. The great work of Ron Dubner, who actually, well before these other people, showed that this predictive coding in the nociceptive system actually is in place. And I don't have time to go into it, but they trained owl monkeys to respond to either noxious or anoxious stimulus. And the monkeys were able to predict with a 98% accurate before the stimulus has arrived. And it was blinded, so the experimenter wasn't in the same room as them. But their nervous systems were becoming highly predictive of the type of inputs they're going to get. Quite a complex experiment, don't have the time. But this is over, if you look at the publication, this is over 10 years. Yeah? Now, those of you who don't like animal experiments, they kept our monkeys alive with electrodes in their head for 10 years. Bit tough. But this is a dynamic causal modelling, one of the first, just published recently last year, the end of last year, on placebo analgesia. So what it allows you to do is they produced all these different models. And then what they did is actually took some functional imaging of people while they're having their experience. And then they used machine learning to see whether or not these models matched. What they're able to produce, and this is what I briefly mentioned to you, Stephen, is they were able to produce these three-dimensional vector models. So now you can see these arrows are different colours depending on how strong or weak they are, and different thicknesses, a bit like in vectors. So they have a directionality, and they also have a weighting to them. So this may be the first time we're doing things like Matt showed you a model based on causal dispositionalism of vector modelling. Maybe we can do it in 3D by marrying different methodologies together. All right, I'm going to skip a few. This is work we did with Abby Tabor, so you know, great work, but about predictive processing about sensory inputs. And what Abby's done is in a control situation, given a red and blue mouse, you know that in the experimental side that actually you're going to give a noxious stimulus or actually a completely non-noxious stimulus. In the control situation, when you ask people to work out how far that mice, the mouse is away from them, it's pretty much the same. But once you get the person to know that the mouse, once they touch it, is going to give them electric shock, they see as much closer to them. All you've changed is context. So now I've changed the context of my prediction, my modelling changes, to say, hey, I better be more aware of my sensory stimulus because this could damage me. All right, but I love this. We did it with patients, with persistent pain patients in input, and you don't get that effect. All right, and I love that. I love the fact we didn't get the same effect. So just because you can predict things in a laboratory on normal, healthy people, be careful about extrapolating it into the clinic. Because when you do it properly, which is the only place to do it, we're real people with real pathology, you can get really disappointed, and I'm so happy about that. All right? This is some of our own work, and I'm now in the third phase of this. This is the first phase. This is people. We took 151 people who had never had acupuncture before. We didn't know what acupuncture was. In fact, actually, they didn't know it had an analgesic effect. So most of them thought it stopped you smoking. All right? And then we tested them all for the rubber hand illusion. When you stroke a rubber hand, did they take ownership of the rubber hand? We got rid of all the people, so there's bias to this experiment, but we needed them to have the illusion to do it. So then we got rid of all the people who didn't have the illusion. Yeah? Okay? Or we knew what acupuncture was. So that left us with about sort of 20-odd people. All right? And then what we did is we established the illusion, and then we put acupuncture needles into the rubber hand. None went into the real hand, and these people had never had a needle past their skin before. They could have been lying, but I don't like to think of people as liars. All right? So I hope they were being honest with us. And those of you who've done acupuncture know that if you classical to chi, the expense of acupuncture gives you these sensory descriptors which suggest, yeah, you might have had an acupuncture experience. And notice my words, yeah? So I don't think acupuncture is acupuncture, I think it's an acupuncture experience. And then we looked. So at the top in red, and this is not how we've ordered it, when we look at the descriptors, there's quite a good degree of separation between the sensory descriptors of those people who've just had a rubber hand experience, those people had a rubber hand experience and acupuncture. So their descriptors are different. The people with rubber hand describe all the classical Cohen and Breivik descriptions of having a rubber hand illusion, but the rubber hand and acupuncture group showing quite different characteristics. Many of those descriptors satisfying the idea that they've received acupuncture, but they've had none into their skin. And again, effective descriptors, same thing. And they also had a highly selective increase in pressure pain threshold within the area of innovation you would anticipate. Well, this was done double-blinded. All right? So the considerations for those who know your pain science, you could say, oh, it's a diffuse nociceptive inhibitory control. Because basically people bullshit that all the time at the moment. It's become the buzz thing, hasn't it? Particularly if you want to get an excuse to hurt somebody. You know, manual therapists are doing it all the time. It's all to do with your DNIC. Rubbish. DNIC, he's got very constrained and defined parameters. You have to be doing a certain type of noxious input, of which manual therapy does not satisfy. All right? Acupuncture would, but here they haven't got the criteria. It's not penetrated their skin. It's penetrated a rubber surrogate. There is no activation of peripheral fibres, and we can demonstrate that with electroneurography. There's no peripheral fibre activity. All right, what about control of pain and agency? Well, sadly, they're not doing it themselves. We've done it with TENS, and that's a consideration. If we get them to dial the TENS in on the rubber hand, then there may be an agency effect. It gives a very similar result. Placebo expectation. Now, I'm not going to get into a placebo expectation thing. Just to say that actually, you know, if you understand predictive processing, you know, placebo becomes an easy thing to see, yeah? But here, I don't think it's an adequate explanation, because if it's based on expectation, it's really truly based on expectation and context, both of them combined, placebo. But the person didn't know what to expect from acupuncture. Yeah? What about a social, cultural construction? Actually, we're in the first phase, because we've done it with Chinese student and then a Thai student. Now we're doing it with Caucasian student. And actually, the results look slightly different, because acupuncture is known to be sort of oriental, so you get a better effect with people who look oriental because they are from Asia. All right, so there may be a socio-cultural mimetic sort of file. But predictive coding, you know, we created an illusion within the higher centres that you have had acupuncture because someone has stuck needles into a hand that you have now accepted as being your home. Yeah? I think it's a nice way to sort of summarise. And just a couple of slight things, if I may. Two slides. You know, this is a way that we might think as well about modelling using predictive processing. This is a beautiful paper by Cole Friston and Chris Frith. And they say, you know, look, what you're trying to do in a therapeutic environment is get your model, your predictive coding, to match that of the person. And you have to listen and interact and take turns to speak and interact. But you shouldn't expect this to happen in one treatment. It's a constant updating. It takes time to build that relationship. But they describe it as a duet for one, and they say it's a, you know, it's not their term, I've given it the name therapeutic song. It says that when you're both singing a song together, it doesn't belong to either one of you. Yeah? You've lost true agency of it. It's between both of you. But you will always frame it like I am singing to give you some contextualization of it. And the other person will say they are singing. Yeah, but you'll both actually say, I am singing, because you're referring to the first person. And that's what we're trying to do, and I think that that's what you guys have been beautifully trying to demonstrate this afternoon. Not trying to demonstrate, what you beautifully demonstrated this afternoon. And we wrote this paper a while ago with Ian Edwards and Mark Jones, the bastions of clinical reasoning from Australia, myself and Dorothy Swisher, talking about marrying the first and the first person ethic, about deduction and induction, how we put those things together. Slightly Aristotelian for my liking in terms of the other three highly Aristotelian philosophers, but you know, nothing wrong with Aristotle, apart from his Greek. My wife's half Greek. Alright? Precision weighting, I think it can help to describe things like Steve Morley and Lance McCracken, who I have the pleasure of working with, idea of this cognitive inflexibility. If we narrow priors, yeah, we make priors more precise, we give an over expectation, if you like, of a pain response to a movement, then that's bringing the resultant, it will bring the experience of the person closer in likelihood to that event happening. So part of treatment for me is you're trying to broaden the probability of an event happening. We're trying to expand priors, we're trying to create flexibility within the system. And so I think all of this stuff provides us, this is the last slide, with a testable hypothesis. I've stolen my own slide from another talk, which I entitled Pain in the Arse or Pain in the Brain. All right. So I think you don't have pain in the arse in the periphery or pain in your brain. I think you have pain in the person. Thanks.